In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. Welcome to Living Word Baptist Church, where the Word of God comes alive. Our mission is to exalt the Savior, equip the saint, evangelize the sinner, and empower the community. Our pastor and first lady are Reginald and Vanessa Fletcher. Please enjoy this recording of a portion of one of our Sunday morning services. And stay tuned at the end for general information about our exciting ministry and how you can get involved. Now, let's enter in and be blessed.
Yes. Hallelujah. Right now, we're going to have Angie Dimon to come up. I'm going to let her introduce. Everybody knows our speaker. He's family. He said he didn't need this, but when you have people that you appreciate and that are special, you exalt them.
Am I getting up here? You're fast. Praise the Lord. I know sometimes we do get comfortable and we say we don't need to introduce the speaker, but we do need to introduce the man of God who's going to bring the word today. They just came back and said, come and introduce your husband. And I was thinking about what I was going to say, but I said, you know what? God knows. Because in this 21 years, going on 22 years of marriage, that's what I can say, God knows. Because there is not a dull moment in our household. And I'm usually the one who's saying, stop that, quit. But you know what? We were listening to a sermon from somebody, we was in marriage sermon or something a couple of years ago, and the minister talked about being a house man, because a husband takes care of the house. And I always call Andre my house man, because he takes care of the house, and he takes care of us, me. And he takes care of his two wonderful children. And I know that we would not be able to stand here today if it wasn't for this man right here praying and covering us. So I just want you to hear what the Lord has for him to say to us today, because I am truly grateful that he's my house band. So I thank God, and I hope you hear a word that will change your life, because he changes ours daily.
Amen. I was looking over there thinking she was talking about somebody else. Thank you, honey. Amen. Came over from Children's Church taking care of Avery just to bring me up. Amen. Good morning. Good to see everybody. Amen. Now, what takes place from this part on is because of your brothers in the back. I was praying with them, and they said, these were their words, be Dre. Now, my wife just stood up here and said, it's never a dull moment in our house. So you've been warned. Amen. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity, O Heavenly Father, to stand and deliver your word, O Heavenly Father. We pray that you open hearts and open minds, O Heavenly Father. We pray that they understand that they have the victory, O Heavenly Father. We pray that they understand that with you all things are possible, O Heavenly Father. We pray that they understand, as they sung this morning, that you are able, O Heavenly Father. They won't give up on you, because you won't give up on us, O Heavenly Father. We thank you this morning that you've been fathering us, O Heavenly Father, and you give us our identity, O Heavenly Father. We thank you that great is your love towards us, O Heavenly Father. And we thank you, O Heavenly Father, that we love you, we love you, we love you more than anything, O Heavenly Father. We pray that you will open hearts and open minds, O Heavenly Father, to receive your glorious word. We pray for our pastor and first lady. We pray for all of our church friends and members that are traveling and vacationing and getting a time to relax. But we also pray for those in here, O Heavenly Father, that are in the midst of chaos, O Heavenly Father. We pray for those, O Heavenly Father, who might be having a health situation. We pray for healing right now, O Heavenly Father. We pray for someone who needs peace, O Heavenly Father. We pray for someone who doesn't know where their ends are going to come from. We know that you are a provider, O Heavenly Father. And most of all, we pray for someone in here who does not know about your darling son, Jesus, O Heavenly Father. May their hearts be changed today, O Heavenly Father. May those that know you, that aren't living for you now, turn their life to give their whole life for you, O Heavenly Father. We thank you, we love you, and we praise you. It's in the matchless name of Jesus we pray and say thank you, thank you, and thank you. All those who agree, say amen, amen. Put your hands together and give the Lord a praise. Amen. So keeping in the theme of this month, talking about wayward fathers. Hey, what's up, bro? One of my brothers that got up every morning at 5:30 a.m. Amen. It's just good to see him. Amen. About fathers and the issues that come from fathers not following the word. Amen. So we're going to go to 2 Kings, if you have your Bibles, if you have your tablets, if you have your phones with the Bible app, go to 2 Kings. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings. 1st and 2nd, go to 2nd Kings chapter 22. We're just going to read one verse. Also, you might want to put a piece of paper in 2nd Chronicles. 2nd Chronicles is right after Kings. 2nd Chronicles chapter 34. For those who've never, I'm an old Sunday school teacher, so I'm going to teach today. Yeah, you're going to get 3 or 4 continuing education credits after this. Is that okay, Donna? You going to get those? Can they get those through Brown Mackey? You get it? All right. Yeah. When you're at 2 Kings, say amen. Amen. We're just going to read the 13th verse. And we're going to deal with the whole chapter. If I have you read the whole chapter, for some folks who don't read their Bible, their brain might explode. So we're just going to make it easy. 13th verse. You got it? All right. Let's read it together off to the screen. And it says, go and inquire of the Lord. Amen. And just for a few minutes, we're going to talk about the fallout from unfaithful fathers. The family fallout from unfaithful fathers. The family fallout from unfaithful fathers. Now, I was in the back and Michael stole my introduction, so he owes me $19.95 doing Sunday school. I heard you, brother. And so have anybody ever been driving down the street and you saw some shoes like up on the electrical wire? You ever seen that before? Yeah. As Michael said in Sunday school, have you ever seen a turtle on a fence post? You've never seen that? Okay. Have you ever seen a casket in front of a church? Okay. And then you've seen it also in a burial plot, amen, going down. Well, do you know what all those things have in common? They didn't get there by themselves. Somebody had to help them get there. The shoes on the electrical wire. Uh-huh. The turtle, the fence, the turtle on a fence post. And if somebody said, I think it was Daryl, how'd they get down? Forget how they got up there. How did they get down? Amen. In the casket. Some things that just don't happen by themselves. Amen. Some things need some help from somebody else. And the sad thing is, sometimes you see people in places they ain't supposed to be. It's because they didn't get the help that they needed. Amen. Amen. And so today we're going to talk about the fallout from unfaithful fathers, things that happened because some things that were supposed to be done didn't get done. Amen. And so to give you a prologue in the text that we're talking about, you probably got a little handout, a beautiful yellow sheet. You can read this whole thing yourself. But we're going to be talking about King Josiah. Somebody say Josiah. And so if you look on the left, down about the bottom, he's about the 4th or 5th one from the bottom, King Josiah. And so I got to start back at the beginning and let you know how they got to this point. There was a guy, you might have heard of him. His name was King Saul. Somebody say King Saul. And King Saul became the king because Israel wanted to be like everybody else. They wanted a king just like everybody else. We don't want to speak to the Lord. We want to have a king, Donna, just like everybody else. Sometimes our kids want to be just like everybody else. They want to have the video game just like everybody else. They want to have the funky fresh Jordans just like everybody else. They want to go see the movie first just like everybody else. Amen. And so being like everybody else gets you in trouble just like everybody else. And so they realized that once they got a king, that Saul wasn't the guy that needed to be the king. Even though he looked good and he smelled good and he was tall and handsome and tall, dark, and handsome and had a deep, melodious voice, came from the right family and everything, he still wasn't the right man for the job. Oh, and on your piece of paper, you'll notice it says kings of Israel, the good, the bad, and the ugly. If you look at the symbol next to good and the symbol next to the bad and the symbol next to the ugly, that tells you what type of king that they were during their reign. Amen. And so once they got the first king named Saul, who wasn't good at all, it says he was bad. That was the seed that was set in the rest of the kingdom. First bad king. And so then they had to get rid of him, and they got David. Trust me, I'm not going to go through all these. Don't get scared. And then they had to get David, because David was a man after God's own heart. Amen. And then David had a son, and his name was Solomon. Somebody say Solomon. And Solomon was known as one of the wisest men that ever lived and one of the richest kings that ever was. Amen. And then a funny thing happened after Saul died. He had a son, and I don't remember which one it was. It was Jeroboam or Rehoboam, whichever one was his king, that his son that was going to be the descendant of the king. And what happened was the elders got upset, because Solomon, to bring peace to the kingdom, to build all the things that he had to tax the people. Somebody say tax the people. He had to get some money and stuff to get all the things that they wanted. So to protect them, he needed some of the stuff that they had to keep them protected. Amen. To build the wall and to build up the temple and make everything nice and pretty. And so what happened was, after he died, they went to his son and said, look, you need to lower these taxes. Does this sound familiar to that? You need to lower these taxes. And then he said, no, I'm not going to lower the taxes. So they said, well, fine. We're going to put Trump over. I mean, we're going to put the other brother and make him the king, because you won't lower the taxes. Amen. And so because of that, a split happened in the kingdom. And that's where you see the split on your piece of paper. That's why there was one king over one part of the kingdom, and there was another king over another part of the kingdom. Amen. It's amazing what little things cause splits and schisms in the family. Amen. Maybe a little money, you fine with everything, peace and quiet, but I don't want to give to the family reunion. I don't want to help pay for the family vacation. I'm glad we celebrate our pastor, but I don't want to give to the pastor's anniversary. Amen. I want the parking lot to look nice, but I ain't going to give to that. Amen. We want some nice choir robes, Donna, but I, hello, wake up. Uh-huh. They told me to be Dre. Hello, good morning. All right. And so that's where the split came from. Somebody say that's where the split came from. All right, and so then what happened was, every time they got a king, almost every one of them were horrible. They were bad. You can look down there, good, bad, and ugly. They had a few kings that were good, but most of them were bad and ugly. Mm-hmm. Most of them were bad and ugly. And so if most of them were bad and ugly, what do you think happened to the rest of the population? Mm-hmm, yeah. And so what happened then is where we get to where we are now. Josiah, somebody say Josiah. Josiah becomes the king. Oh, goodness. Whew, that was a lot. Alrighty. So somebody stay with me. I'm just going to walk you through this. The first thing that happens when fallout from unfaithful fathers is your pedigree. Somebody say your pedigree. Your pedigree does not always provide positive examples. Now, pedigree, somebody say pedigree. Yeah, that's a big word. What's that mean? Your pedigree just means your lineage, your family line. You look up at your pedigree, sometimes the pedigree does not provide positive examples. Look at your neighbor and say, well, how is that? If you look back in the chapter right before, because in first chapter of verse 22, it says that Josiah, somebody say Josiah. Josiah became king at 8. He was in children's church and they snatched him out and said, hey, guess what? You the king now. Okay, I want you to vision that. Now, 8 years old, you are not running anything. Amen. You can barely keep your shoes tied, keep from peeing in the bed, and keep from getting snot in your nose. How are you running the kingdom? But when you got unfaithful fathers, the pedigree sometimes, Sam, does not provide the positive example. So you go one chapter, and it talks about who his father was. And his father, his name was Amon. Or if you've been to Jamaica, Amon. His father's name was Amon. And it says in the Bible, in I think it was, hold on, let me see, 2 Kings 21, 19 to 22, it says that he was a horrible king. It said he didn't do the things that the Lord was supposed to do. He didn't do right by what the Lord said. He was a horrible king. He only was king for 2 years. That's how bad he was. They decided to take him out. They did a Michael Corleone hit on him, Daryl. He was only king for 2 years. And so that was his bad example. Again, you don't have positive examples in your pedigree. Amen. And then Amon had a daddy. His name was Manasseh. Okay. In chapter 21, verse 1 and 2. And it says the same thing about him, that he didn't do what was right in the sight of the Lord. He did what he wanted. And so since this boy was only 8 years old, those were the only two examples that he had to follow. Amazing that when you look up in your lineage and you don't see a good example of a good man, where did you get the example from? Do you get it from music videos? Do you get it from the internet? Hopefully you're bringing them kids to church so they can see some good men that is living the way the Lord is telling them to do. Amen. But in his case, he didn't have any good examples. Now, what is amazing to me about Manasseh and Amon was that they had a father and a grandfather. Many of you might know him. His name was Hezekiah. Not the choir director, Hezekiah the king. And it says that Hezekiah did what was right in the sight of the Lord. Even when the Lord told him he was going to take his life for disobeying him, y'all know the story, Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed. And the prophet had just left the room and he said, hey, go on back. He prayed, he repented, and came on back in and said, well, the Lord heard your prayer and he decided to give you 8 or 7 more years of long life. Amen. So it's amazing to me that Manasseh and Amon had this example of a good man to follow, but they decided not to follow in his footsteps. And so I said that part for some parent in here who has set a good example. I set that in here for some parent who has set a good example, who has trained their children right, who has done what is right, has showed them how to pray to the Lord, has got them in beautiful feet, has got them singing in the choir, has got them doing junior usher, has got them in CLD and all kinds of other D classes and whatever it is that you can do to get them good tutoring. If you've done all that and they still decide to do whatever they want, this here is what I'm going to tell you is from the Lord. Please pray and go to bed at night and sleep well, because you have done your job. But if you ain't done what is right, if you ain't been doing the right thing, if you letting your kids call you by your first name, if all they know is mommy be back and daddy be back, then you should be biting your fingernails off. Worry. Everybody breathe in, breathe out. Amen. Sometimes your pedigree does not provide the positive example. And so my question is, how did Josiah get the right example? Because at 8 years old, it says he did what was right in the sight of the Lord. Is that what it said in the book? All right. And so here's some other things that come about because of fallout from unfaithful fathers. The next point, you got premature placement of people in places of power and responsibility. Premature placement. Somebody say premature placement. How many people like to cook? Come on now, don't y'all act like it. I know you like to eat. How many people like to cook? How many people cook cakes? Yeah, what happens when you open the oven too soon? The cake falls because it ain't sturdy enough to handle the heat, to handle the change in temperature, amen? You open the thing prematurely, amen? Imagine trying to put the wrong amount of weight on a child that lifting weights, it can cause problems in their body, amen? Premature. Sometimes when fathers aren't where they're supposed to be, sometimes when parents aren't doing what they're supposed to do, children are prematurely put in places of responsibility that they don't need to be in, having to make decisions that no child should have to make. Yeah, some of us had to take care of our family because mom and daddy was gone too much. Yeah, had to get a job, couldn't go hang out, couldn't play. Had to get a job to pay the bills in the house. That ain't a child's job. That's mom and daddy's job. Making sure your kid, your friend, your sisters and brothers get off to school on time. That ain't your job. Making sure there's oil in the car and gas in the car and food in the kitchen. That is not a child's job. Premature responsibilities being placed on somebody too early, amen? Because the parent, especially the father, is not in place. Hello? Here we got a king at 8 years old having to lead a country. Now let's be honest, at 8 years old, you ain't leading nothing, amen? But he has the title, and really everything falls at his feet. There's some things that he shouldn't have to worry about. There's some things that children shouldn't have to worry about because the fathers, the parents aren't being responsible. Is everybody okay this morning? Amen. Hopefully in your family, if you've done this, you need to start taking back the reins. Amen. Maybe that's for some reason some kids are still mad at their parents. Amen. I didn't get to go out and play ball with my friends. I had to be working at Walmart. I had to worry about the gas bill. I had to worry about the light bill. I had to make sure that the kids, my brothers and sisters, notes got signed for school. I was at the parent-teacher meetings. Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. Amen. Premature placement of responsibility. Amen. Oh, the next thing that happens, fallout from unfaithful fathers. Positive people have to pull double duty. Positive people, somebody say positive people, have to pull double duty. If you look down here in verse 1, it says Josiah was 8 years old when he became king. He reigned 31 years in Jerusalem. And it says this, his mother's name, somebody say his mother's name. His mother's name was Jedidiah, the daughter of Adiah. She was from, I can't even say that place, Bozkath. And verse 2 says, he did what was right in the Lord's sight and walked in all the ways of his ancestor David. Positive people have to pull double duty. I always wondered when I read this, Donna, how did an 8-year-old figure out how to do what was right? Because we know that his daddy wasn't about nothing. Y'all can say amen. Amen. Y'all know y'all say another word when you're at home. But he ain't nothing. Amen. And then we just read that his grandfather wasn't nothing. Amen. So how did an 8-year-old figure out how to do what was right? Well, if you've ever read the Bible, you know when they talk about lineage, they never talk about the mother, really. Amen. They always talk about the father, and he was the father, and he was the father, and he begat, and he begat, and he begat. Amen. But it says right here that his mother's name, they mentioned his mother's name. They mentioned his mother's name. Mamas. They mentioned the mama's name. Let me see. I wrote it down here. The mama's name. Yes. Her name means beloved. And the father, the grandfather, it says she was the daughter of, what did it say? The daughter of Adiah. His name means witness of God. So I'm just going to, as Pastor says, use my sanctified imagination that the only place he got the positive stuff that he needed had to be from his mama, who was pulling a double duty. She had to be the mama and the daddy. Happy Father's Day. The grandfather, who should be resting right about now, had to step in and be the father also, to help his daughter out, who's raising not just a son, but a king. And see, sometimes, I've done it myself, we just see ourselves as trying to get these kids out the house. Just let me survive one more day, Lord. Lord, just keep me from killing them today, Lord. If they come in here and say one more thing, Tone, I swear for God, today, Lord. Because we only thinking about today. But we don't see that there's an eternal ramifications. There's something bigger going on. You ain't just raising a child. You raising somebody's mother or father. You raising somebody that might be the next president. You raising somebody that might be the next cop that runs into a crazy situation. You raising the next doctor. You're raising the next elected official. You're raising the next person that could be teaching your children Sunday school. You're raising the next pastor, the next choir director. When you look at it that way, you got to bring positivity to this double duty. Because if you don't do it, it's obvious the fool that the daddy and the granddaddy ain't going to do it. So somebody who's positive has to step in and do what needs to be done. Not just for them, but for a greater good. For a future that we don't even see yet. Hello? Are you seeing the importance now of your place, fathers? Are you seeing the responsibility why you need to be their mothers? Do you see why you need to be their grandparents? Do you see why you need to step in aunties and uncles, deacons, ministry leaders? Why you need to be on time for choir practice and Sunday school and choir practice and all that stuff. Leaders and teachers, amen. There's something greater that God is trying to get to, not just in you, but in those he's put under your tutelage. Amen. So we talked about the pedigree does not always provide positive examples. We talked about premature placement of people in places of power. And we talked about positive people pulling double duty. Yeah, you got to do it. You might not want to do it. Yes, this is your time to go on cruises and go cruise around the world, Paw. But your grandbaby needs you. Your niece and nephew needs you. That child needs you. Amen. Trust me, I sure want to go. Donna, I said I wasn't going to say nothing about a cruise when I got up here. I sure want to go on another one. I just saw a picture on my Facebook feed this morning that said, "Oh, come on, Mon, come on back. Come back to Jamaica." Positive people pulling double duty. Amen. Amen. The next point, the fallout from unfaithful fathers. Now, this might take a little second, so you're going to have to see this one. We're going to go to Chronicles in second chapter of Chronicles. Chronicles chapter 2, verse 30, chapter 34. Prolonged progress because of problems left over from previous generations. Prolonged progress. Because of problems left over from the previous generation. It's a shame some generations can't move on because they got to have a chicken dinner every time somebody die. Just to bury somebody, to take care of all the debts that somebody then left behind. That's okay, we all got them in our family, just say amen. We got to take care of the stuff that mommy and daddy was supposed to take care of, and now we can't move on. Prolonged progress because of problems left over from the previous generation. I was watching this video I got from my house. It's called Generation One. It's talking about multi-generational wealth, trying to get pass it on from generation to generation. And it talked about the problem in the African-American community is that we think wrong about money than other folks, than other races, than other classes. When a person of a different race goes to college, it's paid for. Because when the baby is born, the family started saving for the college. But when we go to college, we come out with $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 of debt. So we're behind the eight ball. And then those same kids, when they get married, their parents in another class of people, they have already paid for the house. They either give them a down payment on the house or they buy them a start a home. So they don't have to have any debt in their first house. And so if I'm starting behind the eight ball hula line when I go to college, and then I get out of college and get my first job that ain't even the same amount as what I just borrowed to go to college, and then I see Fine and Sexy, and I get married to her, and then we get married, and we spend all this money trying to be ballers at the wedding, and then we get moved into our house, and then we put we get it in debt on the house. We got all this debt that we basically are paying off for our whole life. Whole life, we behind the eight ball. We're not building wealth. We're not passing on blessings. We passing on debt. We passing on problems and complications and situations. Amen. But the Bible shows that prolonged progress because of problems left over from the previous generation. Somebody go to 2 Chronicles. 2 Chronicles 34. 2 Chronicles 34. 2 Chronicles 34. You okay? Everybody okay? All right. We're going to start at, I'm going to start at the third verse, chapter 34. You there? Third verse. And it talks about in the eighth year of his reign. Now he started out, he was king at eight, right? 8 year of his reign. Now he's 16. I'm going to do the math because I don't know what kind of class I got today. He's 16. And it says, while he was still a youth, Josiah began to seek God of his ancestors. Now, how is it a 16-year-old is smart enough? That goes back to my previous point. How is he smart enough, Donna, to know with no Bible to seek God and start praying? It had to be his mama and his granddaddy. Again, pay attention. He was still a youth. He began to seek God of his ancestor. And in the 12th year, somebody just say the 12th year, so 12 plus 8 is 20. Okay. Now he's 20. It says he began to cleanse Judah and Jerusalem of the high places, of the Ashtaroth poles. These are all idols. Okay, this is something that the whole people of Israel was supposed to do when they entered into the promised land. They were supposed to do that way back before they even got King Saul. And here is King Josiah, 20 years old, 800 years later, dealing with something that his family was supposed to take care of. He got rid of the high places, the poles. Verse 4, then in his presence, somebody say in his presence, the altars of the Baals were tore down, and the incense altars that were above them chopped down. He chopped them down because there's some stuff you got to do. There's some stuff you can't delegate. There's some debt you're going to have to get out yourself. Amen. Hallelujah. The Ashtaroth pole, the carved images and the cast images, he shattered. He crushed them to dust and scattered them over the graves of those who sacrificed them. He burned the bones of the priests on the altars. These are the priests of Baal. And he cleansed Judah and Jerusalem. He did the same in the cities of Manasseh, Ephraim, and Simeon. And as far as Naphtali and on the surrounding mountain shrines, he tore down the altars. He smashed the, whatever that word is, poles, and carved images to powder. He chopped down, somebody say, he chopped down. He chopped down all the incense altars, the places where they prayed to these other gods. He threw out the land of Israel, and then it says he returned to Jerusalem. All this stuff he had to do that should have been done by his forefathers. All this stuff that causes delay when mama and daddy are not doing what they're supposed to be doing. Let the church say amen. Prolonged progress because of the problems left over from previous generations. Verse 8 says, and in the 18th year, now he's 26. I'm doing the math for y'all again. In the 18th year of his reign, in order to cleanse the land and the temple, Josiah sent these other folks, it says, to repair the temple of the Lord. He had to do all this other stuff just to get to repairing the house of God. How is it the house of God fell in disrepair all these years? All these other guys. How is it some folks down there can't make the choir practice? It's because all this other stuff is more important. All these other guys, all this double time and working overtime they got to do when they swore that they was going to be a choir practice. Who lying? How is it we can't get folks to come and teach the Sunday school for the young kids? It's because they was out too late last night, worrying about other things that wasn't God's thing. Mighty quiet. excuses are tools of incompetence built upon monuments of nothingness. And those who choose to specialize in them are seldom good for anything but excuses. That was beat into me when I was pledging. That's why I know it so well. There will be no excuses. Prolonged progress because of problems left over from the previous generation. The other problem that was left over, and I just read it, the temple of the Lord was all beat up and run down. Now, it's a little warm in here right now. Everybody's fanning. But there are some fans. There is a ceiling fan. You might not believe it. The air conditioning is on. Thank you be to God for a pastor who made plans and provisions. He saw all y'all before any of y'all was here. But those things don't run by themselves. They need some tithes and offerings to keep the electricity on. Amen. If something goes wrong with them, you sure gonna be complaining. When I'm in the sound booth, when I'm not preaching, ain't this right, Jess? Brother Dre, something's wrong with the toilet in the bathroom. I work in the sound booth, man. This is my area of expertise right here. But I have to leave the sound booth, Donna, to go jingle the chain in the bathroom. Because people don't like when the house of God is falling down. And so how is it for hundreds of years, the place was not repaired? Because you read down there, it says they had workers. They had skilled artisans. They had people that was ready to do the work. Well, the reason the work didn't get done was because provisions were improperly placed in the potter's house. That's the next point. Look at your neighbor and say provisions. In the 9th verse, going down to 18, it says something. I'm going to skip down. Verse 9, it says, they went to Hilkiah, the high priest, and gave him the money. Somebody say the money. Brought into the God's temple. Now I'm going to go down. They put some of the money into the hands of those doing the work. I'm going to skip down. Verse 14. You got verse 14? It says, when they brought out the money that had been deposited into the Lord's temple, the priests found the book of the law. Because see, the people kept giving their offerings to the temple, but the money, the provision was improperly placed. It was so improperly placed that the money piled up and the word of God was hidden under the pile of money. And see, this is fallout again from unfaithful fathers. Because if I know we're supposed to be following the word, Tyrone, sooner or later somebody gonna say, where's the Bible? Excuse me, but I didn't give this amount of money. How come I don't see no stripes on the parking lot? I know how much money I've been given. Why are these things happening? Hello. But maybe you don't wonder what things are happening because maybe some folks ain't giving nothing. And so there's nothing to worry about because nothing from nothing leaves nothing. And you got to have something if you want to be. Yeah, y'all know the song. It says when they pulled the money out, they found the book, Donna. And again, this shows you, back to my original point about the positive. He did all this stuff without the word of God. Prayed. Positive input from somebody who remembered the word. Because the declaration was the word was supposed to be read every so often through the whole congregation, through the whole city, through the whole country, so that no one was without excuse and couldn't say, well, I didn't know. See, what happened was, yeah, no excuse. Somebody say no excuse. Here's the last point. Somebody say the last point, because he's stepping all on toes. So we talked about the pedigree. Somebody say the pedigree. We talked about premature placement of people in places of power. We talked about positive people pulling double duty. We also talked about a prolonged process. The process is taking too long, amen? Because we had to do stuff for leftover generations. And then we talked about the provision improperly placed in the potter's house. The last problem, the last fallout from unfaithful fathers is problems understanding the prophets and following the word of God. Because there's no man or woman of God in the house that's able to share what the Lord has told them. Does it sound familiar, brothers? They get up at 5 a.m. If somebody goes home and shares what the Lord has told them, because there's nobody to do that, then when the king, who's now 26, excuse me, hears the word. Now we're back in the 13th. Remember that verse we read? He says, go and inquire of the Lord for me and for the people and all of Judah about the instruction of this book that has been found. For great is the Lord's wrath that is kindled against us because our ancestors have not obeyed the words of this book in order to do everything written about us. The king was so confused that he said, we got to go get somebody else. Because this is even, I don't understand. First of all, he's probably saying, how in the world are we just now hearing about this? You ever go to family reunion and be like, whose child is that? How is it I'm just now finding out that that's Bucky's baby? Come on, come on, come on, come on. You know how you get upset when you say everybody else knows something and you just now finding out about it. That's why y'all watch them Tyler Perry shows, I know. Well, here's the king. I've been the king this long and I'm just now finding out about this. What? It said he tore his clothes. Two verses before that, he tore his clothes. He was so upset because something had been kept from him and the rest of the country this long. Something good, something that needed to be said, something that could save their life, something that could keep them from doing wrong. And the sad part about this is when you read the rest of the story, Josiah was the last good king Israel ever had. His name meant Jehovah has healed. And even when he went through and cleaned all the stuff up, even when he went through and restored the temple, even when he went through and restored the Passover and did all that stuff, it still didn't keep destruction from coming. because it had been too long. It was already on its way. And so the question for us men, parents, how long are we gonna let foolishness continue to go on? In the house, with our kids, with our grandbabies, with our nieces and nephews, in society, on the job, in the church. How long? Because if we don't do something about it, destruction is coming. And if we don't get it right, my pastor said all the time, they got jails and prisons for the kids that we don't raise upright. Brother Hulan mentioned this picture we saw on Facebook. It says, everybody wants to talk about this generation, but they forget about the folks that raised it. And then I posted it on my Facebook and said, or didn't raise it. Because there's some stuff you just ain't gonna let go on too long. Amen. Everybody take a deep breath. Everybody take a deep breath. And so you say, what is the answer today, Brother Dre? Since I brought the bad news. The good news is there is an answer. And his name is not Allen Iverson. His name is Jesus. Aren't you glad? Tone's clapping like, woo, thank you, God. That was scary, all of that. His name is Jesus. The good thing about Jesus is we all had a poor pedigree coming up. Going all the way back to our worst great-grandfather, his name was Adam and Eve, amen? And if we lived on that positive example, none of us had a right to the tree of life, amen? But because of the second Adam, we do have, excuse me, not the second, the last Adam, we do have a right to the tree of life, amen? Some of us have been placed in premature places of responsibility because of sin, amen? But thanks be to God who is rich in mercy. He provided us a way, amen? We've had positive people pulling double duty in our life, amen? For so long we had a pastor who had to do it all. Mom and daddy, if you had a good mommy and daddy. But I'm so glad the positive person in my life that made the most was Jesus, amen? Was that word of life, amen? Prolonged progress. Some of us have been behind the eight ball, amen? Born in Gary, born in Hallville, born in a cabin in Texas, born, yes, we just been behind the eight ball. Brightwood, Hallville, too far, you know. We just behind the eight ball, amen. Went to the worst IPS school, had the worst teacher. But God, who was rich in mercy, erases all that, amen. It's by through Christ you have been justified and made righteous. Look at your neighbor. I'm so glad. My pedigree. Yes, uh-huh. I'm so glad the provision has been placed in the right place. Amen. Everything that looked like it wasn't working out right, God placed me in the right place. He had my mother. I was raised by a single mother, so I'm not sitting here down in single mothers at all. You are seeing the evidence of what a single mother can do. With a left hook and a couple of belts and some switches and putting me in the right places. Ain't that right, Sonya? What she couldn't do, she made sure I got to the right places and got the right provisions. I had the right coaches. When I was talking crazy, they kicked me in the chest. This is back when you could do that type of stuff. You talk crazy in school, they took you to the wrestling room and said, oh, you bad? Let's get bad. You only made that mistake once. Sonya, Mr. Yonelson, 6'8". First of all, why are you talking crazy to a man who's 6'8"? Put you in the right place, amen? I'm just saying, my mother knew who to get me to, amen? And then my first pastor, Pastor Hicks, told me things that I couldn't believe a pastor would say, but I needed to hear them. And it kept me moving in the right direction. That's all because of Jesus. And I'm passing that information on to these kids that are going away to college now. Some of you folks who know, I've told your kids the exact, cleaned it up a little bit, things that my pastor, my first pastor told me. And it kept them in school and kept them out of trouble. Graduated too. I'm telling you, you got to have the right people. in the right place to pass on the right things. Amen. But it's not me. It's the He that's working in me. It is Jesus. Amen. Problems understanding the prophets. Thanks be to God that He gives the word and gives it plainly. If you come to Living Word and come to any study at any time and don't understand the word, there's nothing wrong with the teaching that's going on here at Living Word. There's nothing wrong with the teacher. I know some of y'all have your preferred teachers for Sunday school. I know some of y'all have your preferred teachers for your kids in certain classes. But if somebody's willing to do the teaching, you just need to get them there. This is all that the Lord has provided for you. But the thing is, you won't be able to get it if you don't know Jesus first. I'll stand. The doors of the church are open. Everybody on their feet. The first call is for anyone. It's for anyone who does not know Jesus as their Lord and Savior. You need to get that right. Get that right first. Because He will do exceedingly abundantly above all that you may ask or think. That's the first call. The second call is for the people who know Jesus. But you know you're not living right for Him right now. You're living opposite of what you know the Word and how your family raised you in the Word to be. If you know you need to get your life right, come on up front right now. We got people who will pray for you and get you on the right path. Amen. And the last call is for mothers and fathers who have not been doing their job. You know you've been absent, missing in action. But today, you are dedicating the rest of your life to fixing what you messed up. If that's you, come on up front. We'll pray for you as well. As we've seen from this text, there's fallout from unfaithful parents and fathers. Amen. Don't be afraid. You ain't the only parent in here. If that's you, come on to the
Lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your path. Beloved, we are thankful, excited, and humbled that you decided to worship with us today. We pray this recording has been a blessing to you, and that you are not the same person you were before you heard it. If you're interested in worshiping with us again, our normal Sunday morning service times begin with Sunday school for all ages starting at 9 a.m. And our Sunday morning worship and celebration begins at 10:15 a.m. We also have midweek Wednesday Bible study at two convenient times, either 12 noon or 6:30 p.m. For more information about our church and other ministries, please check out our website at www.lwbcindy.org. That's www.lwbcindy.org. Or friend us on Facebook or follow us on Twitter at lwbcindy. Beloved, we just want you to know we love you, and remember, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. May God bless you and keep you.